Good evening and welcome to the WDSU News Hot Seat. I'm Travis Mackle. Tonight we are, of course, talking about really the biggest legal story in almost a decade in the city of New Orleans, the trial of current Orleans Parish DA Jason Williams. A lot has happened during week one. We're moving into week two starting tomorrow, and we have a good panel to discuss it right now. Mike Kahn, former NOPD SWAT team commander, security expert, and two lawyers here, Pat Fanning, who does current defense but was a former prosecutor, and Sarah Shavinsky, a defense attorney here in the city of New Orleans. First off, everybody, thanks for joining us.
Thank you, Travers.
Thank you.
All right, Mr. Fanning and Ms. Shavinsky, we're going to get to you all in just one moment here about the legalese and what you all think was the good, the bad, and the ugly of what happened in court. But let's start off with Mike. There was a big security concern this week, not something anybody expected. We knew Jason was going to trial. We knew things were going to get interesting from the prosecution and defense standpoint. What we didn't know is that there were going to be threats made, according to NOPD and state police, that would lead to Jason Williams gaining access to a private entrance and having to wear a bulletproof vest on his way to court. In today's world, and look, it's horrific what has happened with mass shootings across this country, but gun violence is out of control in a lot of cities. In today's world, how serious do law enforcement leaders have to take any potential threat to a sitting elected official who's on a criminal trial right now?
So anytime that comes across, Travers, you have to look at the threat. You have to see where the threat's coming from and the validity to the threat. You have to investigate it and decide how far it should be taken. And something like this, out of an abundance of caution, he still is one of the chief law enforcement entities as the district attorney in the city. And you need to give him that credence and that ability to make it safely back and forth and give him whatever he needs as far as security with the threat being made against him.
The threat was online. And look, we all look at social media. I was looking at it before we started this segment. Twitter can be a dark place. So can Facebook and Instagram. There are a lot of people who say and do stupid things on social media right now. But do law enforcement leaders, do the marshals, and do NOPD and state police have to take even something small very seriously because people say stupid things and they give you an indication that maybe there's something else out there?
You're correct. You have a lot of these keyboard cowboys, if you will. And behind the anonymity of the computer, they will send messages and say things and be a little bit more verbose than they normally would. When something like that happens, you have to look at it, but then you do have to investigate it. You have to look at when it came in, where it came from, and what the validity is. In the event that it's something, you can make a couple of minor changes just to promote the security and make sure everything goes fine. Then you will do that in a case like this.
All right, Mike, stand by. We're going to come back to you with security as we move into week two. But let's get to the legal point of this. Pat Fanning, Sarah Shavinsky, thanks for joining us right now. Sarah, let's just start with you and then we'll finish up with Pat here. You've been watching the trial. What is your key takeaway right now? A lot of people feel, and I hate to put it into a sports term here, that it's really 50-50, that there were good days for the prosecution, good days for the defense right now. But as we're moving into the second week here, what's your biggest takeaway?
Sure. Thanks for having me. So, you know, 50-50 is definitely not a great place for the government to be, certainly not as they are winding down towards the end of their case. You know, we have seen numerous witnesses called. We have seen, obviously, the person that was supposed to be the star witness for the government, Henry Timothy, of course, the tax preparer, testify. But, you know, what we haven't really seen so far is what some people might categorize as like a smoking gun, right? There was testimony from Henry Timothy sort of suggesting that you know, Jason Williams and Nicole Burdett, you know, influenced him or pressured him to commit crimes. But we haven't seen documents, emails, text messages, phone calls, any kind of smoking gun that would support that testimony to this point yet.
Pat, what do you think about week one? What's your biggest takeaway?
I don't think the government hit any walk-off home runs during the first week. It seems to me that it's a much more closely contested case than we usually see in federal court. The questions I have are for the week coming up, what's left. A lot of prosecutors save the best for last. You know, they want to leave the jury with the strongest witness that they have. So the question in my mind is, are they going to follow up what is to me a relatively weak week that they had with somebody really strong at the end? And then after that, does the defense feel a need to even put on a defense? And if they do, do they put the defendant, does Jason Williams testify?
And look, just for the record here, Mike Magner and Lisa Wayne. Lisa Wayne is one of Jason Williams' attorneys. Mike Magner is representing Nicole Burdett. They represented a well-known doctor in the city of New Orleans about 5 years ago and didn't put on a defense, and the jury came back 45 minutes later, not guilty on all counts. So, Pat, let me start this legal question with you. As Sarah just brought up here, Henry Timothy was supposed to be the star witness. I think a lot of people felt he was a bad witness and that maybe they put him first because he may have been very, very suspect as a witness and on the witness stand. It seems like the FBI's number guy, the guy who digs into the numbers, who was on the stand the bulk of Friday, was probably their best witness so far. And a lot of stuff he was throwing out there, life insurance policies on the ex-wife and all these expenditures, it seemed like it may have not been germane to the case, but it resonated with the jury. What do you think about that?
Yeah, I would have to say Tim Moore, the IRS agent that you're talking about, he's been around since dinosaurs roamed the earth. You know, I've cross-examined Tim Moore many times, and he always comes across well. He's always prepared. He's a smart guy. And I think that my takeaway was he put some stink on him to the extent that, yeah, he probably took too many deductions. But now my question is, are they going to be able to overcome that selective prosecution argument? Or is the jury going to say, hey, everybody cheats a little bit, or a lot of people cheat a little bit. It's not worth it. Why did they select him out of 1,000 returns and bring him to trial? So I thought Tim Moore was their best witness so far. I don't know if it was enough. And I guess we'll see. We'll see if the defense thinks they even need to put on a defense this week.
Sarah, what do you think about that, about the IRS or the FBI numbers guy? They called him on our set the other day. Somebody called him a human computer. It seemed like he was probably the strongest witness for the government so far.
Sure. And, you know, calling a witness like that towards the end of the case is something that you typically see in federal court from the government. They'll sometimes refer to them as an overview witness or like a wrap-up witness. And the idea is that you bring someone on who's very knowledgeable, who comes off credible, who can kind of try to put all the pieces together for the government in a way that hopefully the government will be able to persuade the jury that they have all the pieces. You know, I think the issue with Agent Moore, first of all, we haven't seen all the cross-examination yet. And so he may be looking, you know, credible and thorough right now, but by the time the defense attorneys are done, it may not seem that way. But the issue with Agent Moore is that, you know, his testimony is going to be limited to what's in the documents, the financial records, you know, the tax filings, and he's certainly very good at that. But, you know, the key issue in this case is not whether or not these, you know, tax returns were fraudulent. It's clear that there were some deductions that were taken that shouldn't have been taken. I think everybody's agreeing to that in this trial, including the defense. But the issue is who's responsible for that? If it's Henry Timothy, the tax preparer, who put himself out as an accountant, a CPA who wasn't, who's sort of been a convicted liar and has a history of this kind of behavior, or whether those, you know, fraudulent components are a result of willful conduct on the part of Jason Williams and Nicole Burdett. And I'm not sure how much Agent Moore is going to be able to really speak to that issue.
Hang tight, Mike. We're going to come back to you in just 1 second, but let's get one more question each with Sarah and Pat over here. As we move into Monday and the rest of the week, Bobby Hertzberg, a longtime ally that we all know of Jason Williams, who has also taken a misdemeanor charge here for tax purposes, is set to testify. There's been chatter, maybe he doesn't. If they call him to the stand, could he be possibly, I know both of you all know him, could he be the strongest witness moving in to the close here for the prosecution? Go ahead, Pat, if you want to start.
Okay. Well, he could be a strong witness for them if he comes in and says things about this knowledge or intent and comes in and says, Jason and I had discussions about this and we said, you know, we're sticking our necks out here. We know this is a crime, but let's do it anyway. Then he's a very important guy. But if he comes in like Timothy and says, maybe he knew and maybe he didn't, I don't know. We never discussed it particularly. Now, the government's got to be arguing when people commit crimes like this, they don't send emails and say, hey, tax preparer, let's cheat on my tax returns. If I'm the government, I'm going to be arguing, I wouldn't have expected to see any emails saying that. Whoever puts in writing, I'm going to commit a crime, or I know this is a crime we're committing, and then you expect the other guy to bring it to court. That's kind of crazy. But Hertzberg could be an important witness just because they are weak on that area.
What do you think, Sarah? Do you think he's going to be an important witness, or do you think it's just par for the course from what we've seen.
I do not think that Bobby Hortzberg is going to be the key to this case for the government. I'm certainly willing to be proven wrong on that if it comes out in court. But you know what he pled guilty to was, as far as my understanding, is one count that had to do with his own taxes. He wasn't charged or convicted of anything to do with a conspiracy. Based on what we've heard in court so far, the opening statements, the testimony, I don't have any reason to believe that he's going to come in and say that, you know, Jason or Nicole told him anything about their intent or knowledge about this plan. I would be surprised if he was going to somehow turn this around for the government. If they're not already across the line, I'm not sure they're going to be there.
Really quickly, like I said, Mike, we're going to get to you to finish up here in a second. But really quickly, Sarah, the final three charges deal with Jason Williams and Nicole Burdette not reporting cash payments. A lot of lawyers deal in cash, especially criminal defense attorneys. You and Pat both do it for a living. There are clients that you all represent that don't have the means to pay by credit. They give you cash. A lot of people feel there's not a great defense for that right now. Was it just a mistake that they didn't report it? The government hasn't harped on it a lot, though. Do you think they try to finish with that and sell that to a jury? Because it does seem, as of now, that could be the low-hanging fruit for the government.
Well, if I was the government prosecutor, I would take $108,000 and put it in a grocery bag or a briefcase or whatever and come in and dump it on the table and close an argument and say, how many of you have ever seen cash like this? Obviously, you deal in cash because it's hard to trace and therefore you can leave it off your tax return. So I'd be harping, I'd be hitting on that, especially since they don't look like they've, cinched this thing otherwise.
Yeah. What do you think, Sarah, about the cash and the cash payments? It seems like it's just, look, you're a defense attorney and you can have a defense for everything, but it just seems like everybody's interested to see what the defense is going to be when that comes up.
Yeah. I mean, you know, these are the first individuals to be ever charged with failing to file this like relatively obscure tax form, I think in 50 years in the Eastern.
I think it was 44. Yeah. It's a long time. Yeah. Almost 50 years.
It's not something that is necessarily common knowledge among people who don't have a lot of financial expertise. That willful standard applies to those charges as well. And so I think, you know, there's no dispute that those tax forms were not filed. And so the only question is whether or not that's willful or that's, you know, something that they reasonably relied on their accountant, who they thought was a CPA, to tell them to do and they didn't. I will say, as far as the amount of cash involved in the case, the government has spent a lot of time just sort of creating this image of this office with a safe and cash floating around and, you know, the lawyers paying for their expenses in cash. And I will say that I do think their intent is to try and make the jury suspicious of that or to think that there's something nefarious going on there. But I do think it's important to note that of all the charges that are part of this case, there's no charges for tax evasion. In other words, there's no charges for collecting cash payments and then not reporting that cash as income. So as far as the government knows and is concerned, all the cash that came in was reported as income. The question is just whether the deductions were improper or whether the proper forms weren't filed.
All right, Pat, Sarah, we appreciate it. Mike, let's get back to you to close here. This week, as we move forward, does Jason Williams, the current DA, still get the same courtesy? And how serious do police take this? I mean, look, we're probably in the final couple of days of this trial. Does this threat ever get, do they find whoever made the threat, or does this just kind of die on the vine, if you will, and they take security standards to deal with Jason Williams?
So there are two things to think about this, Travis. One, in the event that this was a threat and it was substantiated, you would see a lot more police out there. You would see the FBI around the building. You would see canine dogs that would be doing sweeps. You would see where they wouldn't allow people to park on Poydras Street for the thought of a potential VBIED, a vehicle-borne IED. You would see other things that would be very visible to everyone walking by federal court. This would be indicative to me that this is not a threat that has been substantiated. And perhaps I think it's something that one thing came across. At this point, you don't want to backtrack and say he can no longer use this entrance just in case you've already started it. So I'm sure they'll continue to let him do it throughout the trial. But I don't think that there's very much to this threat at all.
All right. Mike Kahn, security expert, Pat Fanning, Sarah Shavinsky. We appreciate your time. We will obviously continue to cover everything that happens in the Jason Williams trial, right up to a verdict. We're also live tweeting from inside the courtroom. Once again, everybody, thank you for your time. We'll probably be hearing more from all of you all coming up in the next couple of days. That's all the time that we have for the hot seat. I'm Travers Mackle. You can see this entire segment starting Monday morning online at WDSU.com.